Welcome to another edition of Limra Unplugged. I'm Allison Salka, and today I'm talking with Janella Frias, who is president of Prudential Retirement. Welcome, Janella.
Thank you, Allison. It's great to be here today, and I'm really looking forward to the conversation.
Great, so am I. And today we're going to be talking about the impact of COVID-19 on the retirement industry and on retirement security overall. And as we all know, COVID is a challenge on so many levels. It's challenging consumers, employers, advisors, and retirement plan providers. So let's talk about them one at a time. So based on some research that we did, we know a little over half of consumers said, you know, a COVID-related recession is going to strongly affect their ability to save for retirement. What have you seen in terms of the pandemic? How has it affected retirement plan saving?
Yeah, well, you know, COVID-19 has caused an additional amount of stress with a negative impact on personal finances on an already fragile situation. You know, when you think about prior to the pandemic, 63% of Americans did not have enough savings for a $500 emergency, and almost 25% of adults in the United States had no retirement savings or pension at all, according to the Fed's 2018 report on the economic well-being of the U.S. households. So that is a pretty challenging situation. And as a result of the pandemic, millions of people have been furloughed temporarily or permanently, or have undergone a significant reduction in hours, wages, and benefits, or a combination of all three. And while enhanced unemployment benefits have been helpful, it doesn't replace the entirety of what has been lost. So many have taken loans and withdrawals from their retirement plans. And although this helps create liquidity in a time of need, since many Americans have only their retirement accounts as their main source of savings, it does further compound the degradation of their own personal financial wellness status and negatively impacts their retirement readiness. Now, let's keep in mind that this is the second major crisis in 12 years, and it is likely to have far-reaching implications for savings behavior for different age groups, and also far-reaching implications for whether workers will be able to retire on time. So as a retirement provider, we aren't necessarily thinking differently as a result of COVID, but COVID has highlighted the shortcomings of the current approach towards financial wellness and retirement readiness, and frankly has further strengthened our resolve to prepare all of our clients and their participants.
So has the CARES Act, the Coronavirus Aid, Relief, and Economic Security Act that passed in March, it loosened the rules on taking distributions from 401k plan accounts. You had mentioned, you know, hardship withdrawals or loans increasing. Are you seeing a lot of employees access their savings through the CARES Act as well?
Yeah, so during the first three quarters of this year, we have seen approximately 10% of all participants take a hardship withdrawal, a loan, including CARES Act loans, or a coronavirus-related distribution. So 10% have accessed their retirement savings accounts. Now, the majority of our defined contribution plans, about 90%, allow hardship withdrawals and or loans. So they already had access, and they have access as well through the CARES Act. 55% of Prudential clients elected to add coronavirus-related distributions, higher loan limits, and or loan suspensions according with the provisions of the CARES Act. And plans also have continued to offer traditional hardship withdrawals and loans in addition to the temporary relief for distributions and loans available under the CARES Act. And this brings me to the very important concept of emergency savings. And again, we have seen participants tap into their retirement savings accounts. And frankly, that is because that is often the only source of savings that Americans have. And when employees take loans or withdrawals from their retirement account, it impacts their ability to retire on time because they are withdrawing money that had been set aside for retirement that may never be replenished because it may not be replenished. And also, it does impact their ability to enjoy the benefit of the compound interest when they leave the money in the account. So this could result in employees delaying their retirement and having to work longer into their older years, which is a challenge. And it is also a concern from the employer perspective, from a workforce management standpoint, if employees are waiting to retire. Now, an in-plan emergency savings account is designed to be a source of liquidity when an individual has an emergency. So we do expect participants to withdraw that money when faced with an emergency, and it will not have the same impact on an individual's retirement readiness because it is coming from an after-tax fund that is earmarked for this purpose. So the goal here is to prevent individuals from taking out a hardship withdrawal or taking a loan that could later be defaulted on. Now, what we've seen during COVID is that while adoption of emergency savings by additional plans has slowed again during COVID and due to other areas of concern and focus, we do see participants still contributing. So we have about 25 clients live as of 9/30/20 with emergency savings capabilities. That makes emergency savings available to 80,000 employees within our system. And just about over 2,200 of those participants have an after-tax emergency savings balance, with the average after-tax contribution being 4.1%. So that's a good amount that individuals are saving. And in fact, a recent study conducted by Prudential found that 23% of our plan sponsors do plan to include emergency savings as an offering in their plans going forward. So we see good traction. And of course, this pandemic has only just been a reminder of the importance of emergency savings.
Yeah, I think, you know, we've seen as an industry, those were something that I heard more about a few years ago, and suddenly it's coming back. And I think it may be a reflection. Employers are really trying to figure out all of the different things that they can do to help their employees. And I think you mentioned 23% of plan sponsors that you had surveyed intended to add one. For the sponsors that are adding it, you know, what is it that is resonating with them when you're talking about why to add it? And for sponsors who aren't adding it, what are the reasons that they're giving you for not doing something that seems to be such a valuable resource for participants?
Well, I think for sponsors that are adding it, it is really that very stark and serious reminder of seeing the fact that they have employees that are tapping into their savings account, their retirement account, to meet these short-term needs. And it's, again, a reminder and a proof point that having emergency savings is critical. And also a connection of the points of the fact that in order for employees to be able to save for retirement, they really have to be financially well along that entire journey, which means having funds set aside for emergencies. So I think, again, anytime we have one of these crises or events or pandemics, in this case, it's just a reminder of making sure that we, as plan sponsors, the goal is really to provide all the tools so that employees can be financially well along that journey. For those that are not considering offering it at this time, it is more around the fact that, you know, employers are focused on the well-being of employees as well as of their businesses. And in my mind, it's a matter of time before they can, you know, really focus back again on the plan design. And we're very focused on working with our clients on that optimal plan design that really has all the tools available to their employees and their participants.
Yeah, when you look at employers, you know, again, so many of them are trying to help their employees, but at the same time, they're running a business. And while the employees are facing challenges, both financial or, you know, mental or in so many other ways, employers are facing challenges of their own. We know that more than 7 in 10 companies that we surveyed said they're concerned about the impact of the crisis, frankly, on their business, you know, as well as on their employees' retirement readiness. So I'm curious, you know, what you're hearing from employers and plan sponsors, because obviously it's a challenging environment for them. They have to worry about running their business. They have concerns about healthcare and the costs of healthcare, you know, making benefit changes. So what are you hearing from the employers and plan sponsors that you work with?
Yeah, I think that's, you know, you raise a great point, right? You think about all the challenges that individuals have, but employers have many competing challenges and issues as well, obviously caring for their business while caring for their employees. You know, initially, plan sponsors were focused on obviously understanding the provisions of the CARES Act. and on making decisions about which provisions to make available, and on really striking a balance between making this important source of liquidity available to their participants while protecting their retirement savings, right? And ultimately, they had to communicate and really make these provisions available. So that was, I would say, the original area of focus. At the same time, sponsors were asking advisors and providers like us for data on participant behavior, especially at the onset of the market volatility, because this goes back to then being well-informed and in the future being able to make those changes to plan design. So we received hundreds of questionnaires from clients and advisors asking for participant behavior for their specific plans, as well as how it compared to our entire client base. And for example, just going back to the emergency savings, right? So I think it's a great data point to see how those participants with an emergency savings account behaved versus those that didn't have one. And that's information that we can all really learn from and make changes in the longer term. So that's what the focus has been. Now, as the volatility has started to improve, sponsors have now shifted their focus to really helping their employees improve their financial situation. So we're now at the point where we're taking those learnings from the early days of the crisis and using it to inform and make changes, essentially. They're inquiring about financial wellness tools like emergency savings, student loan assistance, and in-plan income solutions. So sponsors are looking to advisors as well to know the provisions that and what is offered by providers, and really to help them make decisions based on their expertise, as well as based on all this new information we have from the last 9 months.
And I think that information is so important, because being able to make sort of evidence-based decisions, being able to say the outcomes are different for participants who have this plan design feature like student loan or emergency savings accounts is again, it's a really compelling argument to be able to show the impact of that. And so that can be really helpful for having plan sponsors take actions in the, to help them. Participants. And we also know that, plan sponsors have resources among the record keepers and service providers that they work with. And many plan sponsors also work with advisors. And that's been a challenge during the pandemic too, because advisors who service plans and participants needed to find new ways to figure out how to communicate and add value when, travel and face-to-face visits and discussions about complicated topics became a lot more difficult. And we know that, retail advisors are getting a lot of questions about market volatility and the effect of low interest rates, and that there's no shortage of questions that, institutional advisors are getting as well. And I'd be curious, what questions are advisors getting, and what are they asking you?
Yeah, so, it's interesting. Some advisors have said that they have moved from advisor to counselor to educator for their clients, which frankly has enabled them to provide that multifaceted value at a time of great need in our industry. The CARES Act provided the most immediate need for advisors to consult on legislation and really on the impact to clients across the various providers they worked with, because everyone interpreted and implemented things a bit differently. So clients really needed help navigating those impact for their employees. So it kind of first order of importance was implementation of the CARES Act. CARES Act also created a unique opportunity for many advisors to consult on plan design considerations around loans and withdrawal provisions that came to the forefront due to the legislation and frankly, due to the pandemic. And really the way to think about it is, just because CARES Act allowed for a number of provisions, it didn't mean all provisions made sense for a particular employee population. So plan sponsors were faced with a delicate balancing act between providing that relief for employees without opening the floodgates for a run on retirement savings that these participants have worked so hard to achieve. And this is where advisors and frankly providers like us came in and were very helpful in education and really helping make those decisions. Now, with the passage of SECURE Act, I would suspect that advisors and plan sponsors will now need to have a point of view on income. With the income disclosure requirement that is part of SECURE Act, every participant in every plan will now see what their balance converts to and will ultimately ask the question, how do I get this income? And how do I ensure I have the income for the length of my retirement? So advisors will need a response, and it will no longer be acceptable to not have a point of view on income. And frankly, this pandemic has highlighted how ill-prepared American workers are for emergencies. Financial wellness programs have moved from a philosophical kind of we should be doing this to a strategic imperative for many employers who haven't yet adopted these solutions. So I think the advisors are really getting into the heart of the issues and really helping sponsors with that plan design, because there's only so much benefit dollars, right? So how can we optimize that spend in ways that will ultimately help the participants best prepare for retirement?
And when you talk about preparing for retirement, you're mentioning lifetime income and advisors needing to figure out what solutions they should be recommending to the plan sponsors that they work with. And you talked about how the SECURE Act may be able to help that. I am curious if you expect either the SECURE Act or other changes to kind of make these solutions more attractive or make more people or employers adopt them, I think, because that's been a challenge with low interest rates as well as, you know, complexity just by nature of being able to provide a guarantee and with participants having generally not as much, you know, knowledge of these products. Do you think there is going to be an increase or a decrease in interest in this, or what do you think is going to happen?
I think there's absolutely going to be an increase, and for two reasons. One is SECURE Act, and the fact that, as I said, you know, when an individual now sees what their total savings translates into from an income perspective, it highlights whether do they have enough income or not, and how long will they have that income for, is it guaranteed or not? So one is just SECURE Act, and as well as with the portability that SECURE Act facilitates. But the second reason, and I think the more prominent reason, is that we are at a point where that first generation of defined contribution only savers is getting to retirement. So as we know, defined contribution plans are savings vehicles, not necessarily decumulation vehicles. So we as an industry and individuals, as they start getting to that retirement place, do need to come up with vehicles and solutions for that decumulation. It's not easy. And to your point, there's a question of guarantees, but I think it will ultimately, and the solution will depend on the plan sponsor and the individual, but it could be guaranteed. It could be a hybrid. It could be non-guaranteed, but it's really how we help individuals decumulate on those savings and really create that paycheck and retirement that will be a key area of focus.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, SRI research found that 4 in 10 pre-retirees are very concerned about outliving their assets, and over half don't believe that their existing savings and investments are going to last if they live to 90. So certainly it's an important issue during a time when there are so many other important issues, you know, financial issues that people are dealing with. And so given, you know, again, all of the things that people have to be concerned about related to their finances and retirement savings, if you could only offer one piece of advice to consumers to improve their retirement security, what would it be?
You know, I think the one piece of advice I would focus on is maximize your workplace retirement plan. It is not difficult to catch up if you maximize your workplace retirement plan. And really, I would highlight in really three areas and three ways you could do that. One is to pick a place to start, whether you contribute 1% or 15%, depending on where you are. Something is better than nothing, especially if you factor in the employer match and compound interest. So pick a place and get started. Second is auto escalate. Most plans have an option to automatically increase your contribution by 1% each year, allowing you to effortlessly save more and not even think about it. So auto escalate. And third, I would say think ahead. Utilize tools that help you assess the kind of life you want in retirement, and then match that with the income you will need. So that awareness of how much you will need in retirement in the form of income, not in the form of total savings, is really important, because, you know, then we individuals can make really informed decisions about, are they saving more or not? Are they saving enough, or do they need to save more?
Thanks. So it sounds like you would recommend that people, one, save and save in an employer-sponsored plan because that has the benefit of payroll deduction, which makes it easy for them, right? Because it'll be automatically deducted from their paycheck. And then to take advantage of resources like automatic payroll or automatic deferral increases, again, because that makes it easy for them. They don't have to think, and that activity will help work towards their retirement security, and then to plan in terms of learning or figuring out how much they'll need, and but they'll already be saving and escalating their savings, so that piece will be taken care of. And then the planning piece is where they can really spend their time versus these other activities. So it sounds like it's take a step and do what's easy for you, and then plan. So I think those are really good words of advice. And so I'd like to thank you for being with us today. Thank you very much for your insights and sharing your thoughts and research with us. That concludes another edition of LIMRA Unplugged, and we look forward to seeing you again soon. Thank you.
Thank you.